Greetings, I'm Mr. Spiffy, and welcome to Slamming into SummerSlam. And I'm doing this really, really fast because apparently this is how they decided that the 1990 SummerSlam was supposed to take place, where it was really, really fast all the time. Every match was only got about 5-7 minutes long, and everything went by really, really quickly. There was no denouement, there was no build-up, there was nothing going on, everything went by really, really quickly. Okay. Slowing it down. Taking my time. This is what they should have done with SummerSlam 1990. And they had a lot of high-profile matches, and they had a lot of things that were going on that were right, but they really, really just put way too much into a card that lasted 2.5 hours, and they tried to rush through all the matches. And what was worse is, in a 2.5-hour show, they spent at least a half an hour on backstage segments and interviews. Why? Because when they went on pay-per-view, only 5 minutes was dedicated to doing an intermission, but they gave a nearly 15 to 20 minute intermission where all the interviews were happening for the audience and the arena. Plus, we got an additional about 10 minutes or so as they set up the steel cage for the main event. So they rushed through so many matches. I don't think a single match lasted bell to bell more than about 8 minutes. So even the main event inside the steel cage wasn't that long. Most of the entrance stuff took longer. And it's kind of sad when you think that some of the interviews and the backstage stuff that was leading up to these matches, some of them took longer than the matches. I think the longest match on the card was the one that was designed to be longer, and that's the 2 out of 3 falls match for the Tag Team Championship. But I'm getting ahead of myself here, rushing right on through. So let's go ahead and talk about the actual matches that we had at SummerSlam 90, and boy, were there a lot of them. So we started off with the Rockers versus Power and Glory. Right off the bat, the Rockers are ambushed, and Shawn Michaels has taken out his thrown in, his knee gets injured. I don't know if Shawn was legitimately injured, and that's why they had him pretty much stay out of the entire matchup. I don't know where they were going with this, but honestly, Marty Jannetty fighting back against the two men and Shawn valiantly struggling to try to get back on the apron and try to get into the match at all was really well done, and this is probably the best match Paul Roma ever had. And I actually got into it right off the bat, and I enjoyed the formatting and design, despite the fact that I didn't entirely understand why they did it that way. But in this case, I don't think the why mattered as much as the presentation, and I wound up giving the match a B-. You have an interview with Mr. Perfect talking about having to take on the challenge of a relative newcomer to the WWF at that time, the Texas Tornado, Kerry Von Erich, and how this man doesn't deserve a championship match, but heck, he's magnanimous, he's Mr. Perfect, and so he's going to defend the title. So we move on to the Intercontinental Championship match, Mr. Perfect versus the Texas Tornado. Perfect was dominating this matchup for the first, 4.5 minutes of the matchup. Tornado barely got in any offense, and as I watched this, I was just starting to reach that point where I was getting into the matchup and I was just starting to feel the rhythm and flow where I felt something more was going to happen. And then literally it was Tornado does a slingshot in over the corner into the post, grabs the claw hold, spins around, Tornado punch, 1, 2, 3, we have a new Intercontinental Champion. It was like one of those moments where I'm like, okay, I'm feeling this, and the match is over. It's there, and it's gone. Just like that. But despite that, what they gave us was good. I gave it a C+, but it was an unimpressive finish to a matchup that was the beginning of a rather unimpressive reign as Intercontinental Champion. Does anybody remember any match that Texas Tornado had as Intercontinental Champion, like title defenses or anything like that, that are memorable or stand out? If you have some recommendations for me, please show me, because the only things I remember about his title reign was winning the title, his match at Survivor Series, and losing the title at WrestleMania. That was it. Those three. We have Mean Gene backstage getting ready to interview Sweet Sapphire, but he can't find her. So instead, he gets an interview with Bobby the Brain Heenan. Mr. Perfect is blaming the ring post for defeating him because nobody beats Mr. Perfect, just the ring post. But Bobby Heenan was claiming that the referee had bad counting and was actually at a counted down a three count for a two count. But anyway, you look at it, they were basically complaining that Mr. Perfect was cheated. We then move on to the match of Sensational Queen Sherry versus Sweet Sapphire. Sherry looks like she decided to raid Psychosis's bag. Because, have you seen the mask that she was wearing? She was wearing cat makeup, which just didn't look right on her face. And then she has this mask with points on it. It was either Psychosis or Jushin Liger. And I'm going to find this picture and show it to you, or at least I'm going to try to. But it doesn't look right. So this match has no grade to it because it didn't happen. Sapphire winds up losing by forfeit because she didn't show up. We then move on to the Warlord versus Tito Santana, which was surprisingly okay. But in the end, Warlord picks up a victory and with the running power slam, which is the reason why I guess he wound up facing the British Bulldog. Both of them had the running power slam as their finisher. Makes sense, I guess. I gave the match a C+. Most of this match was carried by Tito, but Tito's a veteran. You then move on to the WWF Tag Team Championship match, 2 out of 3 falls. The Hart Foundation versus Demolition. This is when Demolition first introduced Crush as part of their team, and we never know who is going, which two men are going to defend, but only the two members of Demolition were allowed at ring. Two of the three were allowed at ringside. Vince McMahon, for reasons unknown, kept trying to convince us that Smash and Axe look alike. Let me kind of explain this here. Smash and Axe do their makeup completely different. Axe has short hair. Smash has shoulder-length long hair. Axe is about 50 to 70 pounds heavier than Smash, and it shows in his chest. Smash had big man boobs. Axe didn't. There's significant differences in how they look. They're approximately the same height. That's about as far as it goes. But Earl Hebner, at one point in the match, had to be a moron. Or maybe it was Dave Hebner. Either way, whichever one of the Hebner brothers was refereeing this matchup, at one point, Smash and Axe swapped places, because it was officially Smash and Crush who were in the matchup. He looks right at Axe in the face. I can't tell the difference. Nope. It was stretching my disbelief. Now that I've gotten the bad part of that match out of the way, let's talk about everything that was good. First of all, good tag team wrestling. I liked the way they worked the first fall. The match felt genuine. And hell, had Demolition not had to defend the tag team belts in a 2 out of 3 falls matchup, you actually would have seen the Hart Foundation lose clean, because there really was no cheating or chicanery during the first fall. During the first fall, the worst thing they did was that they threw Anvil into the barricade and then did their double team finish on Bret Hart and pinned him 1-2-3. Fully within the rules of a normal tag team matchup. A little bending of them a bit, but not terribly cheating. Then the second fall happened, and the Hart Foundation hits the heart attack, and for reasons unknown, instead of Crush kicking Bret to try to get him off his partner or anything like that, no, he reaches down and picks up the referee and gives him a big ol' hug. You know, I know he was trying to just yank him away and stuff like that, but it was stupid. And then, of course, they get disqualified, so the second fall goes to the Hart Foundation. They then attack Bret Hart from behind, and while Anvil and the referee are distracted with Bret Hart being knocked out on the floor, out comes Axe, who gets under the ring. At one point, Axe and Smash swap places with their completely different hairstyles and their completely different makeup jobs, so somehow they're the exact same person and look so much alike and they can't tell them apart, despite the fact that they've been in the WWF for like 3 years or 4 years at this point and have always been able to tell the two of them apart. Suddenly, you can't tell them apart. So they did a whole bit where they swapped places, then they swapped back. LOD came out and got involved because Legion of Doom was having issues with Demolition at the time. And Bret Hart trips up Crush, and while Anvil shoulder blocks him from over the top rope, roll up 1, 2, 3, the Hart Foundation are the new WWF Tag Team Champions. I gave that match a B. Despite the stretching of the disbelief, it was probably the most enjoyable match of this SummerSlam and was given the right amount of time that it needed. Although I have a feel that the last two falls were a little more rushed than the first fall. The first fall was given the carte blanche that it deserved. We then went into intermission time, which had a series of interviews with LOD and then the Hart Foundation together. And then Sensational Sherry. Sherry talks about a rumor that she heard about Sapphire. And they go in the 5-minute intermission, and they come back, and they're showing pictures secret video footage of Bad News Brown's Harlem sewer rats, which are just possums who don't actually get involved in the matchup. Thank God, because opossums, you can't control those fucking things. And of course, then they had a picture of the video of the snake Damien in the shower with the snake with his mouth going into the water. More interviews, things with Jake the Snake. Jake can't seem to get Damien to stop wrapping around his neck and up his face. And while he's trying to talk, it's like, yanks him down, and the snake comes back up, and he yanks him down, and the snake comes back up. Just went on and on and on. And then they were talking about, like, all right, these are the matches we're having for the second half of the show. And interviews with Macho Man, and interviews with Dusty, where Dusty doesn't know where Sapphire is. Interviews with Nikolai Volkoff and Hacksaw Jim Duggan, who Volkoff is now an ally of America and stuff because our issues with the Soviets are more or less over at this point. And now we're going into the Iraqi war in real life, and we get the beginnings of Sergeant Slaughter going into being a heel and an Iraqi sympathizer as we get Sergeant Slaughter in the Brother Love show. And he awards a medal for the world's greatest American to Brother Love, and then goes on to state that he's declaring war on Nikolai Volkoff. Okay. Sorry, I got that a little out of order, because there was also Bad News Brown versus Jake the Snake Roberts, which that match wound up ending in a disqualification. Big Boss Man was the special guest referee for that matchup, and Bad News hit Jake Roberts with a chair, and then he got disqualified. This match was bland. I gave it a C. That's the reason why I kind of forgot about it there. We have the Orient Express being interviewed when Mean Gene breaks in, and he's found Sapphire, but she's not talking to anyone. She barricades herself inside of a locker room. We then move on to the Orient Express taking on Hacksaw Jim Duggan and Nikolai Volkoff. Hacksaw Jim Duggan and Nikolai Volkoff should never, ever, 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 ever be allowed to sing. They butchered God Bless America. I'm not going to play any of it here because my ears are still bleeding from that. Matchup itself was okay, and it was exceptionally short. Hacksaw Jim Duggan wins with a 3-point stance clothesline. And I gave it a C+. There's nothing terribly wrong with it. You have Dusty Rhodes backstage trying to get to Sapphire, trying to get her to come out. No luck. We then move on. Dusty Rhodes comes out to the ring for his matchup against the Macho King. Macho King has an interview, and then gets carried on his divan, or divian, or however the fuck you pronounce that. However you pronounce that thing that they carry kings and queens out on.
No idea. I've only seen it.
And so, as far as the match went, we were about to have the match get started when the Million Dollar Man, Ted DiBiase, comes out and distracts Dusty Rhodes and shows off that the reason why Sapphire wasn't around is because he's bought Sapphire! Because everybody's got a price for the Million Dollar Man! And Dusty Rhodes goes to try to get an explanation and gets bombarded by Macho King. I like the storyline as they presented it in this matchup, with Dusty clearly being distracted and upset but still trying to pick up the victory over the Macho King. In the end, Macho wins the matchup by cracking Dusty over the head with the loaded purse of the Sensational Queen Sherry and picks up the pinfall victory. I wish this match had gone longer. It had a good story, it had a good element. I think it could have drawn out more. But at this point, the rule of the game was to go very, very fast for tonight. You know, that was the way they were doing it all the time, all throughout this entire event, was just to talk really, 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 really fast and get through everything really, really fast. So, that's where they went. Dusty Rhodes runs backstage, and but doesn't make it in time for when Sapphire and the Million Dollar Man take off in his Cadillac limo. As for the match between Macho King and Dusty Rhodes, I gave it a B-. It was very enjoyable. I just wish there was more of it. We then move on to their double main event. Earthquake versus Hulk Hogan. A match that I described as clusterfucky but enjoyable. As, honestly, these two had a decent matchup. Big Boss Man was in the corner of Hulk Hogan, and you had Dino Bravo and Jimmy Hart who were in the corner of the Earthquake. Lots of outside interference. This match should have ended in disqualification in like the first 45 seconds of the matchup because too many people were getting involved. Boss Man was hitting Earthquake. Dino Bravo was hitting Hulk Hogan. But they just kind of let it go. But as in the end, Hogan wins the matchup by countout. He tries to slam Earthquake through a table, but my God, that table's strong. Withstanding the 460 pounds of Earthquake and not breaking, it just sort of fell over. And then you had Boss Man beating the back of a Earthquake with an aluminum stepladder chair thing in it. Just left these big-ass welts on his back, so kind of nasty there. But as far as the match went, it was enjoyable enough that I could give it a C+. It wasn't spectacular. We then move on to the steel cage match for the WWF Championship. Ultimate Warrior defending the title against Ravishing Rick Rude. This match was really not the best. This was actually probably the worst of the series of matches that we saw. WrestleMania, and they started high and they just moved downward. I think WrestleMania 5 and SummerSlam 89 were on very similar levels to each other. This one lowered the bar significantly. Warrior comes out and spends a lot of time running around the ring and running around the cage, and then finally he gets up on the cage. Now, here was the part that I didn't understand. When they rang the bell for the championship matchup, Warrior was on the outside of the cage. He was standing on the cage, but he was on the outside of the cage. If Warrior was smart in this one, and if wrestling was real, Warrior could have stepped down, jumped off the cage, and bam, he would have successfully defended the WWF Championship. Instead, we got a matchup that was mostly them slamming each other into the steel cage. Warrior got busted open slightly. Rude got busted open slightly. In the end, Warrior picks up the win by escaping the cage. And after we get the joy of seeing Ravishing Rick Rude's bare ass exposed to the world. A couple things I noticed was Warrior really abused the fuck out of the WWF Championship belt. One side of the main plate was damaged. The leather was worn and torn. There were discolorations on the blue leather. It just looked really awful and did not well represent the WWF champion. I felt kind of sad for it. I also felt that Ravishing Rick Rude should have won this one because, let's be honest, WWF dropped the ball with him. Think about the fact that within a year's time, the NWA went on to have him have one of the longest reigns as United States champion, and as NWA WCW, he became World Heavyweight Champion and WCW International World Heavyweight Champion, which is just a mouthful in itself when they separated away from the NWA. But he was made a world champion and a main eventer, and the WWF did one experiment with him in the main event, and they're done. This matchup ran about 7 minutes total. Not including the entrances of Warrior and Ravishing Rick Rude. I just don't feel that this match lived up to the standards they set. And it's not their fault, they just weren't given the time. WWF said, we're going to jam-pack this SummerSlam with as much as possible, and they were given very little time to work their main event. Even Hogan's main event with Earthquake was longer, and hell, we still got 4 minutes of Hogan posing afterwards. So, you know, there was so much time that was wasted on backstage segments and other stuff that they really could have given to these matches to help flush them out a little bit more. And I think it would have been a better event overall. My score for the WWF Championship match is an unfortunate bland C. Final score for the 1990 SummerSlam as a whole, is a C+. There was a lot of good in it, but there were a lot of missteps, and I think if they'd given more time to the right matches and given the right carte blanche to it, this event could have shined. Instead, it was rusty chrome instead of shiny silver. It looked as worn and torn as the WWF Championship that was around the waist of the Ultimate Warrior. So, this one being sort of the forgettable SummerSlam is certainly the one that I don't remember much about. I usually remember the 2 out of 3 falls matchup, and people have to remind me that the steel cage match ever occurred. Feel free to tell me what your thoughts were on this event. Was this something that you enjoyed in the past? Is it something that you remember more fondly than I do? Have you given it a watch recently and maybe agree or disagree with me? Please feel free to like, subscribe, and comment as always. And share these videos with your friends. I appreciate it. Alright guys, so next time around, I'll be looking at the 1991 SummerSlam, which features actually one of my favorite matches. Certainly in like my top 20 all-time favorite matches, and that's Mr. Perfect defending the Intercontinental Championship against Bret Hart. Although I might watch that matchup with no audio on, because Mr. Perfect's last manager in the WWF, the coach, who just kept blowing that goddamn whistle, is annoying as hell, and that was a real detractor. But we'll get more into that the next time. I'm Mr. Spiffy, and we're continuing to slam into summer, and I will see you guys soon. Oh yeah, I'll be back tomorrow. Elimination Chamber.